Welcome to the OMG Wrestling Podcast. This is .. And if you're not familiar with .. this is where we dive a little bit deeper into a few topics and we talk about things that are important in the world of professional wrestling. If you want to go ahead and give us a rating on iTunes, all you got to do is go to omgwrestling.com or search OMG on iTunes, and you can get informed of the latest podcasts if you subscribe over on iTunes. But if we want to encourage you guys to give a rating, because we are giving away a $25 Apple gift card at the end of the month to one random viewer who leaves us a rating on iTunes. Also, this is on YouTube as well. If you guys prefer listening to it on YouTube, go to youtube.com/WeCaptureTheFrag. You guys know all about it. I'm Tony Beats Guy here with Ango, and today we're starting off with a hot topic. You want to inform everybody what we're talking about today?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Tony. Today we're actually going to talk about something pretty big, because pro wrestling is always changing. It's always evolving. But there's some things that have happened in the past of pro wrestling that should make a return. And if you guys couldn't already tell, we are going to talk about match gimmicks that should come back into pro wrestling, and more specifically, match gimmicks that we should see in the WWE. Now, I do want to say I have a list of 5 gimmicks, and I know Tony also has a list of 5 gimmicks. So we're going to go back to back, and we're going to talk about some of these match gimmicks that should find its way into the WWE, especially in 2017, because with the depth of the roster, I think some of these gimmick matches can be a pretty huge success.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And with them bringing back the Punjabi prison match, we're thinking that anything and everything could happen in the WWE with gimmick matches coming back and stuff. Some of these you may agree with and some of you may not agree with. I don't know what Ango has on his list, so hopefully we don't have some of the same ones. But I do have a good idea here that some of the ones that I put down here would definitely make the product way better. And not saying that it's the how to solve WWE, but just some of these matches would be fun. We don't need things like a stairs match or a TLC or stuff like that, because we've seen those over and over and over again. So we kind of need some fresh ones. And I think as much as the Punjabi prison match sucks, I will be interested to see how it plays out. So I'm excited for that. Not that it was ever the best match, but it's still interesting that they brought it back. So I guess if you have one on your list you want to kind of bring back, and give me a reason why it should be back, and I'll tell you yes or no and my thoughts as well.
Okay, I think that's very fair. Now, one of the gimmicks that I'm going to go with first, and this is not in any specific order, I think all of these deserve to come back, but the one that I want to talk about first would be the Inferno match. I think we've seen so many great Inferno matches, and I believe the last one that I recall watching was with Bray Wyatt and Kane. This was when Bray Wyatt first came to the main roster. Look, the Inferno match was a match type that realistically it was some real heat. Like that was fire. Like, I'm not, like, no pun, but seriously, like the match itself, the match type itself was very entertaining, because let's be realistic. I mean, we're seeing somebody get caught on fire. And I love the fact that they have WWE officials ringside, and, you know, when somebody's arm touches the fire and they start, you know, to engulf in flames, you know, I think it's really cool how you have people getting the fire extinguisher and everything like that. I think this was a match that if I were to bring it back, let's just say in 2017, the match type that I see working out in WWE's favor would be Undertaker versus Roman Reigns. Like, I love the idea, and I know it's not an Undertaker match, it's more of a Kane match, but I do love the idea of the Undertaker versus Roman Reigns, and I think it would be really cool to see the temperature rise. There's a lot of intensity going on in the ring. I know this is very far-fetched, but I think Inferno match should definitely come back, especially because there's so many cool things that can happen. And one thing I do want to note, the reason why I mentioned Roman Reigns versus Undertaker is Roman Reigns has a very cool outside the ring leap onto the ring apron.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Somehow, you know, this is Roman Reigns. He's a beast. I think it'd be really cool if he can take that hit, and, you know, maybe he gets hit with fire or whatever and he loses because of that, but he also causes a lot of damage, does heal things, and that would be really, really big.
Yeah, I think you're on to something with Roman Reigns being involved in that match, but I think, what about a Braun Strowman, right? You don't really need to have Undertaker come back and do this match. I think if you threw Braun Strowman in there, Maybe some backstage segment where Braun Strowman lights Roman Reigns on fire somehow or something. You know, Braun Strowman can do whatever he wants. So I think at this current time, if you throw Braun Strowman in there instead of Undertaker, I think it'd be a match made in heaven and just amplify their feud. And I always was a huge fan of this match. Just the fact when they would do a bump, the flames would fly up, and I always thought that was really cool. So I'm all for it. Thumbs up for that Inferno match. So what do you think about Braun and Roman instead of Taker and Roman?
You know, I really like the idea of Taker just because Taker's the veteran. I mean, it's not a match type that he originated. But when you mentioned Braun Strowman being, you know, that this is a new era, I can definitely agree with that statement. I think Braun and Roman would be a really, really cool match. I also want to throw in Randy Orton in some capacity. Mm-hmm. I don't know what his feud would be, but I just like the idea of the Viper being, you know, surrounded by flames. I think it would be really interesting.
I think it's good. I like it. We're going to go on my list again. This is in no order of like top ranked matches I want to see ever in WWE. But I do like the idea of a bring it back from, you know, kind of a Undertaker type, Kane type feud. And I would go with the First Blood match. Now,
wow.
You're going with like Braun and Roman. Again, I think this feud is meant for them. I know WWE has a no blood policy, but this is a thing that they could do in WWE. If they want to do one of these, you could have the blood happen and then the EMTs come out, or like the medical people come out immediately and cover them up. I know the whole point is to see the blood dripping down and all that. Maybe they could go that route again. Maybe let you know before you watch it on the pay-per-view that this is going to be whatever TV, whatever rating. But I think that little factor, like blood, when blood is shown in WWE and it's used correctly, I'm not saying you have to do blood all the time, but when you do like a match, like a First Blood match, I think it's perfect. It sets the feud. It adds that little bit of element, like, okay, Roman Reigns really bloodied Braun Strowman or something. I'm just thinking of those two. Like, all these matches are meant for them pretty much. But I do think, like, First Blood would be great. I love the one that Stone Cold was involved with. He even had, like, I think he got busted open backstage. He was going to fight Undertaker, I think it was, in a First Blood match. And he got busted open before the match backstage. So he had a Band-Aid on his head before the match even started, which was even cooler. Because then he's going into the match with a fresh wound and you're like, oh man, what's going to happen? And I think if you did that, even just copy that with Roman Reigns and have him go into a match with a Band-Aid on his head, like, all right, it's going to go down. Is Roman going to be able to survive? And ultimately he would. Even throw like a Brock Lesnar in there. Imagine Brock Lesnar in one of these, or John Cena in a First Blood match. Like, so good. So good.
I do want to chime in on this. So when you first mentioned First Blood, I kind of was like, it doesn't work. I almost kind of gave you a thumbs down.
Yeah.
And the reason why was because we're in 2017 PG product.
Right.
But then you had said something that kind of triggered a thought, and you mentioned the fact that, you know, the ringside personnel would basically come up really quick to cover the blood, you know?
Mm-hmm.
When I think of a First Blood match, I think easily two people that I can see doing it, especially after the recent feud, is Samoa Joe and Brock Lesnar.
Right.
And the one thing that, you know, what ultimately changed my mind from giving you a thumbs down to a thumbs up was the fact that if you could envision a Samoa Joe and Brock Lesnar fight, not a match, but a fight, and the first person to bleed would lose, I think this is one of those situations where I truly believe WWE sees money in the situation.
Mm-hmm.
So when ring personnel come in to cover the blood, the person who's bleeding will fight the personnel, and they get fined and they get suspended. And, you know, WWE opens up a new story, basically, like, hey, we have sponsors, like, you're getting fined. Like, we don't care if you're the biggest superstar in 2017, 2018, you know. I think something along the lines would really allow me to give you a thumbs up. Yeah,
even if they could cover their butts by saying it's, like, non-sanctioned by WWE, we don't want it to happen on our television, but you guys both sign contracts, know what's going to happen. Like, that would, like, I like the idea of the sponsors getting involved. Like, hey, man, we can't have blood on our television. And it'd be like a Brock Lesnar thing or a Joe thing, you know, them just pushing him off. Because it was one of those takeovers where Joe was bloody and he kind of fought him off. I think it was Joe and Sammy. I don't remember.
Yeah.
Joe and, I don't remember who it was. But I remember Joe, like, fighting people off because he was bloody. And that's kind of how I see it going down.
Yeah, like I said, I was going to give you a thumbs down, but when I kind of envisioned it a little bit, I thought, okay, this could work. But this only works with select few superstars.
Mm-hmm.
So that obviously depends, you know, on who on who's on the roster and everything like that. But I think a Samoa Joe, Brock Lesnar first blood match would be my first go-to. And for that reason, I'll give you a thumbs up.
All right.
So I don't know if you're ready for this next one. And let me tell you, Tony, this next match type has actually never been in WWE. So this is something different. If you're a viewer and you do not watch, or if you've never watched TNA Impact Wrestling, I'm going to tell you why this match should be in the WWE. And it's the Lethal Lockdown match. And I'm going to explain why. So Lethal Lockdown, the old school way of this match was essentially like a cage with a top, you know, cage or whatever, with weapons dangling down from the cage. And basically everybody kind of enters with like a time set, just like an elimination chamber, right? You got like a couple minutes and then, you know, one by one by one. And then it's elimination match until the very end, you know? And I think Lethal Lockdown, the reason why I really like the Lethal Lockdown match in the WWE is because there are a lot of tag teams. There are a lot of superstars who can definitely pull off the hardcore rawness of this match. Ultimately, I don't see a lot of people being a fan of this match type because it's a TNA thing. But at the end of the day, Lethal Lockdown, there were some really, 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 really good moments in TNA history. One thing that I can honestly say, you know, and this is the tricky part, the match is more famous for being inside a six-sided ring. So I don't know how that's going to play off with WWE. But at the end of the day, I think there was some really good moments in TNA's history. I think especially when you consider some of the guys in WWE, like NXT, you know, it's smaller arena. I think this could fit really well in that setting.
Yeah, I think you could throw that if you want to do that. You could do it. I think it'd be sweet to do it at NXT or something like that. Where you get some of those, the Authors of Pain maybe in there, Heavy Machinery, something like that, you know, some crazy thing like that. But I like the idea, but I'm going to have to counter that with my pick and say War Games instead. I've always wanted WWE to do War Games, and now they own WCW. There's no reason they can't get this match in WWE. I mean, they've done variations of like team versus a team, or they've done three teams in there, however you want to do it. But I was a huge fan of War Games. I think it was a cool match. It's always like teams of four or five or more, depending on how it goes down. There's two rings, there's cages side by side. And then, they'd have 5 minutes to fight until another person comes in. And it would just, it has that drama because usually the heel team would get a pick first. So then you'd beat the crap out of a babyface. Then the babyface would make the save. And I think it would be great. I don't know that WWE would want to do that because they're going to lose ringside seats, you know, having another ring there, and the cage. But I think if you could do something like that, it would be awesome. They're bringing Punjabi Prison back. So, I mean, War Games or Lethal Lockdown, but I don't, you know, they don't own the Lethal Lockdown match. Lethal Lockdown's similar to War Games, I believe, where the people come in every interval, but yep. It's not two rings and two cages. But I think, you know, if you remember the old War Games, it was like a really low cage. It wasn't like, it was a cell, but it was really low. I think you need like two Hell in a Cells side by side would make it interesting, but that's probably going to be too big for WWE. And I don't know. I like the idea, but yeah, either one would be cool, I think. But I think War Games most likely could happen because WWE actually owns the likeness there.
So I like how you mentioned War Games. And one of your concerns was like, you know, it would take away some front row seats. Now, one of the match gimmicks that I actually put down was the empty arena match.
Okay.
And I'm going to tell you, like, the reason why I want this to come back is, one, it could be pre-recorded, obviously.
Yeah, of course.
But two, I think one thing about the empty arena match is you're solely focused on the wrestling, the emotion, and intensity between two superstars.
Mm-hmm.
So an empty arena match, to me, the first person that comes to my mind for this is John Cena and Randy Orton. Like, these are the two guys that I think of. I think they could pull it off. I think they can have a great empty arena match. And I think what would be really cool is because there's so much history between the two, I can see them going throughout the crowd, you know, throughout the seats, throughout the arena itself. And nobody's in there. You know, it's non-sanctioned. So keep in mind, like, this is not something, you know, this is one of those things where there's no crowd to perform for. And when you watch this on TV, people are going to be, you know, it's going to feel like one of those things where it's like, okay, well, the crowd usually makes the match. Well, this is the one time I believe that the superstars have to make the match, not the crowd. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So I want to see empty arena match come back. And you know what? You mentioned War Games, and that was kind of your concern. So that's why it triggered an empty arena match. But at the end of the day, I think this does work out in favor of the WWE, especially if you're trying to tell a story. And I would add a couple gimmicks inside the match, you know, making it non-sanctioned, making it falls count anywhere, whatever the case may be.
Right. And I don't know if you were familiar with this, but at one time there was an empty arena cage match, which just adds to the destruction there as well, with just having the cage there, like just adding that little bit of element. We never really had like that in WWE. We've had the empty arena match. I like the idea, but I think you could add that element of like having a steel cage or something around it too. Yeah. Where there's just more to do there, and then they brawl outside the cage and all that stuff. I think that there's like a lot of great feuds that could be on there. I like John Cena being involved, Randy Orton would be good, Bray Wyatt would be good in a match like that. I'd even, you know, Bray Wyatt, Braun Strowman, excuse me, Luke Harper, Eric Rowan, any of those guys from the Wyatt family could be good. Roman Reigns would be good in one of these too. Dean Ambrose, of course, would be great in one of these type of matches. Just the wackiness that he is, I think, would make it great. So, I mean, there's a lot of room here, and I think that if they did one of these, they'd have to put somebody like Dean Ambrose or Bray Wyatt in there, probably, to make it interesting.
For sure.
Going on here, I'm going to go to my next one on my list. This is one that we're going to continue on with these crazy gimmicks. We had Inferno, we had First Blood, we had Empty Arena, War Games, Lethal Lockdown. We're going to go with a Buried Alive match.
What?
Buried Alive match is one that we haven't seen in a long, long time. I can't even remember when the last Buried Alive match was. That's sort of the Undertaker's gimmick, but I think it would work perfect around the time. I mean, I don't know. I guess it could work any time with Bray Wyatt, but around the time they were doing the stuff at the compound with Randy Orton, that would be a perfect time to do a Buried Alive match. I think Bray Wyatt bringing it back, putting somebody's name on a tombstone and kind of playing the mind games with them, even like, not if you want to do Seth Rollins, but, you know, that's kind of a thing you could do there. I just think Bray Wyatt would be perfect for a Buried Alive match. And to have that there just adds that little bit of a gimmick there. And it's just like an ambulance match, but a little bit different. I mean, I don't know if you had a casket match on your list, but I didn't put that on my list because it was similar to the Buried Alive match. And I prefer the Buried Alive match over the casket match.
Well, you actually guessed correctly. I did put casket match on my list. And it's funny that you mentioned it too, because if you think about from the perspective of like the live experience, I've never seen a Buried Alive match live, nor have I seen a casket match. I put casket match on my list being contingent on one thing and one thing only. And that would have been Undertaker versus Roman Reigns for Undertaker's last match, in which Roman Reigns literally puts him in the casket.
Oh, now, yeah, that would be great.
That would be the best way to put over Roman Reigns. But I will say I like the idea of everything you mentioned with the compound. I think if you bring back the Buried Alive match, I think the one person that I truly can see getting a huge gain from it would be Eric Rowan, because he still has that very sadistic, dark character.
Right, definitely.
With the sheet mask. So, I mean, both are great match types. I do want to see them come back at some point. Casket match, Buried Alive match, very, very similar. You know, for all I care, you could put the casket in the dirt, you know. Like, it doesn't really matter.
Like the WWE game they had a long time ago.
Yeah. So, I mean, just think about it for a second. You know, you got to be very wary of who you put on there, because for casket match, I only put that considerably for The Undertaker and Roman Reigns. I can't see other people doing well in a casket match.
Wyatt, I still think he would have a chance to do it, but
not a casket match. For a Buried Alive match, yes. Okay. But a casket match, I would say no.
Okay, I gotcha. I guess I'll go on to mine, because that was your other one, right? Your casket match. So you have one more left on your list, I think, right?
I do, yeah.
Okay. My second to last one, which is just no random stuff, is Three Stages of Hell. Like, we have two out of three falls matches, but I want to go back to the original Three Stages of Hell match that we saw with Stone Cold and Triple H, and that was at No Way Out 2001. And it was start out with a standard match, then went to a street fight, then the cage came down if needed. I just thought it was great because they were having that standard match, then the street fight took place. They could go do anything and everything, and then the cage comes down right at the end and they're trapped inside and they have to finish it off. They did other variations where they did a street fight, cage, and a ladder, but I thought that was, I didn't really like that one. Then we had a standard match, falls count anywhere, then a stretcher, and then a lumberjack match, a tables match, and an ambulance match with John Cena right back. That's just overkill. I like the idea of just keeping it simple, regular match, then no rules, then the cage, and then that's how you settle the score. I love it because the street fight, you can kind of go anywhere, and then the cage, you're locked in. You got to finish it off.
Yeah, no, I definitely agree. Three stages of hell can work with any superstar in this situation. I do love the idea of Finn Balor competing in a three stages of hell.
Yeah. Because
he's kind of like the small guy, especially if you have that third match being a gimmick that's like very, very hard for a smaller guy to win. To have that triumphant victory for a smaller guy like Finn would make a lot of sense. I don't know if WWE would ever go Triple H and Finn Balor in a feud, but that would be really cool. I'm going to tell you that my last gimmick match on my list is actually probably the opposite from every one of our gimmicks that we've talked about. And this one might actually shock you, but I want to see this one come back because this match type, seriously, I mean, it built a career for a superstar, and that's the hair versus hair match.
Oh, that was not what I was expecting. We went more violent and now we got a hair versus. Okay, go on.
Yeah. So, I mean, you got to consider hair versus hair match. I mean, it's the reason why Kurt Angle is so famous. We've seen so many funny moments with Kurt Angle wearing the wig, and then he officially accepted the fact that he was going bald and everything. So a hair versus hair match, I think it works with anybody in this on the roster. I think the only few guys that really make sense to do it would be somebody like Chad Gable, Elias Samson, someone that's like kind of on the rise. I think somebody can utilize the embarrassment because they can turn that into a very, very good heel turn. So somebody who loses a hair versus hair match, turns heel, goes crazy, starts freaking out, and next thing you know, they become a star.
What would you like to see Baron Corbin, right? He's got a big receding hairline. How would he look bald?
Well, he has facial hair, so I can see them pulling it off. I mean, if you have facial hair and tattoos and like you have that dark image, you know what I mean? I guess you can pull it off. But if you were looking at putting like a guy like who else? Like a Matt Hardy or Jeff Hardy, for example, I mean, like you can't do that. If you try to put a guy like Braun Strowman, like I don't think you can do it, you know.
I think it's got to be someone with really long hair to lose it, yeah. And then that would be the way to go. But I think Baron Corbin, man, my dude, he's got the receding hairline. Just get it over, get a goofy heel over on him or something, you know.
Anybody. Aleister Black, yeah, Aleister Black. Yeah. I mean, these are guys that can really unleash hell, you know, after the fact they lose. So that would be really, really, really good.
All right, this comes down to my final one. See if I can top the hair versus hair match. I have a championship scramble match.
Oh.
Let me ask you right away. Were you a fan of the championship scramble?
No.
Really? Not at all?
Not at all.
I was a huge fan of the championship scramble match. I thought it was really cool. At one point, Brian Kendrick was the world champion, if you remember, in the championship scramble
match.
I'll tell you the rules of the match. I think it's like every 5 minutes, a new person comes out, and whoever gets a pin is champion at the time, and they do it until everybody's out there, and then they have another time limit countdown or whatever, I believe is the rule. Something to that effect with the championship scramble match. Time limit to be, you know, it's under the WWE clock, so they kind of stretch or do whatever they want to do with their time, you know. It's not really 5 minutes, but...
Yeah, for sure.
So, yeah, we've had lots of them. We've had the World Heavyweight Championship, the WWE Championship, and the ECW Championship. Again, like I said, we did see Brian Kendrick was champion at one point. Do they count that as the final? No, he's not in the books as WWE Champion. So that's how it works. You get 5 minutes till every superstar comes out. Then you have 5 minutes after that, after the final person comes in, and whoever wins or gets the person to submit is the final official champion. I think it adds like an element that anything can happen, really. Really, you could put anyone in this match and make it very interesting. I think you could fill this with any number of superstars, Raw, SmackDown, or both, and have a surprise person come out on top, be the winner, would be very cool there.
Yeah, I mean, here's the one thing to take away from all of our gimmicks. They all make sense, even if I don't agree with all of them, or whether or not you agree with all of them. Mm-hmm. But a lot of these make sense. The big thing is really knowing who should be involved and who shouldn't be involved. I think at the end of the day, Lethal Lockdown is a match that was really cool in TNA. Do I think WWE can pull it off? I mean, there's some things that they have to do differently. But at the end of the day, I mean, you mentioned War Games, and you brought up some serious concerns about it. So the one thing I could say is a lot of these match types have a place in WWE, even regardless if First Blood is included as well. You know, there's always a place. It's just how they book it and who they put in these matches. At the end of the day, I think you can create a star out of any one of these gimmick matches, which is really cool. And I think that would be the reason why I would try to bring them back. But other than that, I mean, I think my favorite one out of my list is hair versus hair. I think it just makes the most sense. But that's just my personal opinion.
Yeah, I like the hair versus hair match. It could make somebody a star that's not already a star. I think it's great. Championship Scramble, I've been wanting them to do that over and over and over. I really enjoy that match. So Championship Scramble's top on my list. And also First Blood. I just think that makes sense, you know. Have someone buck authority and beat up the officials trying to patch them up. I love that. But yeah, so that's what I'll say. We'll end it here. Let me know what you guys think if you're watching on YouTube. Make sure you leave a comment and let us know which match you would like to see come back in WWE. We don't have an official email set up, but I'll get one set up before I post this live. So if you want to send us email, you can send a message to tony@omgwrestling.com. I guess will be the best way to set up the email. I don't know what else to do. How's that
sound? No, that works. That works. That's better. Trust me.
All right, we'll go with tony@omgwrestling.com. Also, just social media, Twitter, @TonyPizzaGuy, and you can tell them all your social media stuff if you want.
Yeah, you guys can follow me on Twitter @TangoWithAngo, and that's pretty much all you need to know.
All right, guys, and again, this is on iTunes. Make sure you leave us a review, because at the end of the month, we're giving away one $25 Amazon gift card, or Amazon, iTunes gift card, excuse me, Apple gift card to anyone that leaves a comment, random person. I said Amazon just out of the top of my head, but maybe we'll do that in the future. But I'm choking up here. I'm losing my voice here. I need to get some water. So Ango, you want to close us out here?
Yeah. Thank you guys for watching. Don't forget about that contest. That contest is going to be really cool. So you guys want to support the show. The best way to do it is by sharing it and leaving a positive review. Otherwise, follow us on our social media and make sure you guys are subscribed on YouTube. And I'm pretty much going to leave it at that. I don't have a famous sign off. So everybody take care.